Well, we're visiting with Mr. Brown, and this man has a lot of tales to tell, and perhaps in the short time that we're dropping in today that we'll be able to talk about one in particular. And his father, John M. Brown, was mayor, the first mayor of Sunny Brae. Now, Sunny Brae, at that time, was a small community outside the town of Moncton, and has since amalgamated with Moncton. Do you remember, Mr. Brown, when your father was elected mayor of Sunny Brae?
Yeah, I do so. He had quite a time that night. There was another fellow run against him, and he was pretty cross because he wasn't elected. And they had, of course, it was almost like a chivalry. They was up and down the street here, and they come in here, and my mother had happened to have some stuff cooked. And then a lot of them come in here, and they couldn't have cleaned us out what we had to eat. Had a good time that night.
Did they have a campaign?
No. They just come in.
I see.
No campaign for election,
yeah,
you mean? No.
Right.
Well, no, we had no campaign at all. Father didn't do much campaigning at all. But there was two or three fellas bound to have John Brown for a mayor, and they went around the city, town here.
Mm-hmm.
And a fella told Father, he said, Brown, they can't beat you. They can't beat you. He said, I know that.
Well, there were quite a few in the council, too, according to the picture we see.
Nine fellas elected, that is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What was it like to be the son of the mayor of the town of Sunny Brae in those days?
What was it like?
Yeah.
Well, I don't think it was like anything different at all. I never thought it was. We were just the same. We had to go in our shirt sleeves and work. We couldn't wear a white collar after he got mayor. There wasn't money enough this in town to buy him a white collar. That don't help any of us having one, but we worked just the same.
Well, did they bother him as much as they bother the mayor and councilors these days?
Oh, no, it was different altogether. They didn't have that. They only had a council meeting once a month, and there's a few complaints that come in, as I said, to about some fellow having a pig or two or three hens getting over in the garden, one complaint I remember, a lady had complained about a fellow having a pig come to, and she got the council all out there, and they got the Board of Health. And I come to find out the pig's place was cleaner than hers. So that's true. Now that's the kind of arguments that went on them days.
So there weren't very many earth-shattering arguments, eh?
Not too many.
This cane that I have, I don't know if we can see too much of it. Was this presented to your father when he retired from the council?
No, before. One year or two before, I don't know it. Yes?
Town Council of Sunny Brae, January 1st, 1918.
Yeah.
I bet you keep that as a real treasure then.
Well, yes. Money couldn't buy it, that's sure.
Mm-hmm.
That's sure. Of course, I don't use it. It's too long for me. I'm so short, you know. That'd be no good to me.
Yeah. Tell me, you used to drive a team of horses when you were a young man, eh?
Yeah, until I got old, too. I drove
until
all
you got
my
old?
Life. I had a horse up to about 3 years ago. Yeah.
How did you happen to get into that line of work?
Well, that was the only transportation them days was horsing, and it was the only thing to work with. When we broke roads in Sunny Brae here, we broke them with horses. On sleds. We didn't have no snow blowers or anything. The snow was blowing around you all the time, of course, but we broke home roads with horses.
Did they clear the streets in the wintertime in those days?
No. Not after the first streets that I know, they used to clean Main Street and St. George. That's in the city of Moncton. But Sunny Brae never done anything like that.
Yeah.
They just get out with your horses. They'd fella come along and say, come on, get them horses out here. We want to get around these roads after a snowstorm. And they all went out. And they'd fella take a shovel and there'd be a dozen out and shovel these snowdrifts. I've seen snowdrifts down just like this, up and down,
mm-hmm.
right out here. Well, he shoveled through one gold piece, strike a negative stripe, and cut along first rate. And there come a little snow. In the spring of the year, you'd be driving up on the road that high on top of snow. Soon it begin to come warm, your sled's cutting off, and you get stuck. Your horse be off the road, and you have a big time. Mm-hmm. Getting late at night, not getting in, wonder where you are. You'd be stuck on the road with the soft, like the spell we had a while ago,
right,
you know?
Right.
But we were happy.
How many people lived in Sunny Brae when it was incorporated?
Somewhere around 800, I think. I think it was somewhere around, I think it was about somewhere, just enough to be incorporated anyhow.
So it's not true that Sunny Brae had a larger population then than it does now?
Oh, no, no. Sunny Brae, when it was incorporated, was just, you might say, pretty near all on that side of the Irishtown Road. When I first remember here, not a long time, I cut hay all over this place up here. Clean up to the Baptist Church and all around over that side here, that was all a hay field. That was all a hay field. We made these roads through in 1905, I think.
Times have certainly changed then, haven't they?
Oh, I guess so. I think it was 1905 when this was laid off here.
Mm-hmm.
And there were no houses up here at that time at all when it was incorporated, I don't think. It was all on that side.
Right.
There might have been an odd house or two. 1912, or was it 12 when it was incorporated? Something like
yeah.
that.
Your father was a contractor? You said he built bridges.
Yes, he contracted some. He built some houses. The last bridge he built, was down at Calhoun's. A covered bridge, there are two spans. And that was built in 1906. And they tore it down here 3 years ago.
Did you work with him in those
yes,
days?
Yes, I worked with him. I framed that bridge. I framed it. It's a wooden bridge, of course. We framed that down there. I framed that. We couldn't get a hold of a framer, and I was no framer. But I had a plan, and I spoke to some of the fellows that had framed bridges, an old fella. And I watched him, and I said to Father, I can frame that. So we went at it, and we did. We framed it. It got along well.
How about your school days? Did you go to school here in Sunny Brae?
No, I went to Louisville. I went to Louisville. That's where we went. Although we were supposed to go to Humphreys, I think. That's where we should have went.
But you went to Louisville instead.
Oh, yes, a lot shorter. We used to go right there. There was a bridge right here. Right up back our land here, right across the railroad there. We crossed that bridge and then right across the street to the school. So it was a lot shorter.
Did you like school?
Like
Did
it?
You like
oh,
yes. School?
Oh, yes. Yes, we liked it. We had to like it for one thing, because our parents, we had parents that we had to do as they said, you know. We couldn't run around all night to come stay all the way from school. When school was out, we'd come home. If we didn't, we knew why we didn't.
You mean you couldn't stay out after 12 o'clock at night?
Oh, 12 o'clock at night. That is a thing we never heard tell of. We didn't know what 12 o'clock at night was then. 8 o'clock, half past 8, we'd be in bed, especially in the wintertime. And we'd be up about 6 o'clock, half past 5, 6 in the morning, from wrong.
You never questioned that discipline?
Oh, no, we didn't.
Whenever your father said, go to bed, you went.
No, we didn't tell him what to do. No, he didn't say we wouldn't go.
Yeah.
Well, we knew that. We were brought up right on the start. But anyhow, we was generally tired enough to go to school. There was nobody running around here much to go out with anyhow. But after we got big, we never went out with these people.
Mm-hmm.
No, we always was home.
Well, you must have had some time for skating or sliding?
No, I never skated much. I don't know why. I skated a little, but not too much. I was always driving horses, I tell you. On Saturdays when we come home from school, in the wintertime especially, I'd be up at 4 o'clock feeding them horses for Father, so I could get going to the woods with them the next morning. Boys, he'd say, this is a great start this morning. Great start this morning. We'd be away at 6:30 going to the woods.
Well, undoubtedly, that's why you've lived such a long, healthy life, getting up early in the morning and That working might, hard.
That might be, but the Almighty kept me in health.
Yes.
The Almighty that kept providing me.